This is the Archibald Gallery. Situated in the heart of London's West End, these elegant walls provide the backdrop to one of the largest private art collections in Britain. They also constitute the scene of a bold and daring crime. On the afternoon of Saturday the 14th of June 1986, according to eyewitness accounts taken shortly afterwards, two men came flying in on ropes, SAS style, through that window. They landed about here. They immediately overpowered the security guard, whom they subsequently tied up, gagged, and locked in his office. They then disconnected the alarm system and removed two paintings from their frames on the walls. They then hurried through this door, excuse me, can we keep the way clear, please, and down this corridor. Through these doors, this is the office where they imprisoned the guard, and out through these doors here, excuse me, sir, thank you. Onto these steps, they then ran down them, sprinted through this courtway here, gangway, excuse me, thank you, through these gates. They then crossed the road. At this point, they decided to stop to see if any way they were being pursued. They decided they weren't. They then turned, ran towards a green transit van, not unlike this one here, except, of course, on that fateful Saturday, there wasn't a policeman approaching it. And as a result, they got clean away. The Archibald art robbery took place in the West End of London on a busy Saturday afternoon at the height of the tourist season. Consequently, there was no shortage of eyewitnesses.
From their testimonies, the police constructed these various likenesses of the two men. Because of the wild discrepancies amongst these descriptions, detectives chose to concentrate on the testimony of the security man who'd been held prisoner by the two men. He provided them with details from which these two drawings were made. The two men, said the guard, were in their mid to late 30s, both well built, and weighing approximately 15 stone. 6 weeks later, the police arrested this man, 18-year-old, 8 stone, Kevin Watts. From that day to this, his parents have consistently maintained that their son is innocent.
Well, we just don't think he did it, do we?
No.
I mean, he doesn't know the first thing about art, does he?
Oh, well, he knows what he likes.
Yeah, he knows what he likes, but he doesn't know what's worth nicking, does he?
Oh, no.
Kevin Watts was charged with the theft of two paintings. One by J.M.W. Turner, called Black Ice, and the other by John Constable, entitled The Farm Implement. On the legitimate market, these paintings are regarded as priceless. That's about £8 million sterling. On the black market, it's estimated that they would probably fetch about £2 million. But where could the thieves unload two such well-known paintings?
Abroad, definitely. They'd have been conveyed out of the country by postcard smuggling.
Postcard smuggling? What is that exactly?
It's a standard method of getting very well-known masterpieces past customs. The painting concerned is cut up into 5 by 3 inch postcard-sized pieces. Then each piece is simply posted to an address abroad where the painting's put back together again.
Wouldn't that destroy a painting?
Essentially, yes, but it doesn't affect the value. Of course, the method does have its drawbacks. The Turner, for example, would be a devil of a job to put back together.
There is direct evidence that postcard smuggling was used, at least for the Constable painting. This piece of the farm implement was recovered by the police after it had been incorrectly addressed. It comes from more or less the centre of the picture. Does this mean, then, that its absence from the picture would attract attention?
Oh, yes. Well, a painting with a 5 by 3 inch hole in the middle would be fairly easy to spot, even for the relative non-expert.
What are the requirements, would you say, for someone who wanted to commit a robbery of this kind?
Contacts with crooked art dealers, art experts here and abroad, and, of course, a fairly strong pair of scissors.
Contacts with crooked art dealers, art experts here and abroad, a fairly strong pair of scissors. Could Kevin Watts, an 18-year-old schoolboy, have had access to all of these? At the time he was arrested, Kevin Watts was living at home with his parents. The detective in charge of the investigation, Inspector George Dickens, therefore suspected them of involvement.
They suspected me of being Kevin's fence, his middleman, his connection with the international art world.
Do you have any connection with the international art world?
No.
Well, you used to have those magazines upstairs, though, didn't you?
No, Yvonne, those don't count.
What magazines?
Artistic magazines.
Yvonne.
Studies of young ladies without their clothes on. You had loads of them, didn't you? Was quite a connoisseur, weren't you, Brian?
Oh, I dabbled, but it wasn't exactly the international art world, was it?
No, so...
Well, they came from Copenhagen.
Thank you, Yvonne. We do know where they came from. They're just not relevant. Oh, I haven't even got them anymore.
No, right. That's right. The police took them away when they searched the place.
They searched the...
Could we claim for them on the insurance, Brian?
I'll look into it. Could we please change the subject?
You mentioned the search, Mrs. Watts.
Mm. Oh, yes. The police searched the house from top to bottom,
top
didn't
to
they?
Top to bottom.
It took them ages.
Mm.
Especially after they found the magazines. They were stood over them all morning, weren't they? It was not a very enjoyable experience, I can tell you.
No.
Of course, in the end, they didn't charge us with anything. But they still haven't returned our floorboards,
no.
Have they? Or our doors.
And they borrowed a pair of my shoes.
Yes, that's right. They borrowed a pair of his best brown shoes. They absolutely ruined them.
Did they explain why they should boil your shoes?
Yes, they said it was...
Forensics.
You know, forensics. They said that the shoes had been boiled for scientific reasons, not easily comprehensible
to the layman.
Kevin Watts has always maintained that at the time the robbery took place, he was with his girlfriend Jackie Ross doing his homework. Jackie Ross asked us to ensure that during our interview with her, her face would not be seen, not because she has anything to hide, but because she is painfully shy. We agreed.
So you're saying that he was with you that night?
Yeah, he was, yeah.
But at his trial, you said that he wasn't. Why is that?
It's Inspector Dickens, he made me say that. I wanted to tell the truth. I even made a statement saying that Kevin had been with me, but he said it was inadmissible evidence.
Why?
Well, because it was wrong. He made me tear it up. And then he came round the house late one night and told me all about the lie detector test and how it can make you sterile, and about that new operation they developed to see whether you're telling the truth.
What operation?
Well, you know, the one where they open your brain up and have a look at it. Anyway, by this time we woke my mum and dad up with all this shouting, and they'd come downstairs and were standing over me and telling me to do whatever the inspector wanted because they had to get up and go to work in the morning. So in the end, under all the pressure, I just cracked and signed a statement saying that Kevin had told me he couldn't come round that day because he had to go out and nick a couple of priceless paintings.
Thank you very much, indeed.
Kevin
Watts was brought to trial on Monday the 6th of April, 1987.
Doing me homework.
At the trial, the court heard evidence from an ex-prisoner, Jerry Brown, who had shared a cell with Kevin Watts whilst they'd both been on remand. Brown claimed that Watts had confessed to him that he had indeed committed the Archibald robbery.
Oh, he done it. We said he done it. Well, I can believe it in all. Right ruthless bloke, that Watts. He was the hardest man in that, Nick. Ruled it with a reign of terror. When he got mad, we all wet ourselves.
Hmm.
All right. Knuckles, they used to call him. Knuckles.
Soon after Brown gave his testimony, he was granted early parole. Was Kevin Watts the hardest man in the nick? Had he ruled it with a reign of terror? And had he confessed to Brown that he had committed the Archibald art robbery? Brown's testimony aside, by far the most damning evidence against Watts was his own signed confession.
Yeah, I done the blag, Gov. I'll hold me hand up to it. It's a fair cop. But do us a favour, Keep the porridge down to single figures, will you, Chief? I mean, he doesn't actually sound like him, does it?
No. I've never heard him say black before.
No, not black.
Whatever his parents thought of this confession, the jury certainly appeared to believe it, because on Wednesday, the 15th of April, Kevin Watts was found guilty and sentenced to 5 years.